Have you been told that moss only grows on the north side of the tree? Don't worry, it's time for the Survivalust and Mountain Dew Show.
Get you one of those, okay? You're gonna put it in your wallet. You're gonna keep it. Because one day you're gonna find yourself wanting to know where north is. And this is a little survival trick that I want to teach you today on how you, without the aid of a compass or your phone or even the park ranger, if you get lost in the woods, this needle right here will save your life. But not just a normal needle. You have to magnetize it. Now there's a couple of different ways you can magnetize a needle. You can take a sharp piece of steel, like a knife edge, and strike the tip of the needle, not the eye of the needle, but the tip of the needle. You want to strike that needle over and over and over in the same direction, not back and forth. But you want to magnetize the needle by creating the electrons. And the way you do that is you strike that needle in one direction over and over with a sharp instrument. So if you don't want to do that and you're not comfortable and you don't think that's going to work, you can always sort of just dry test your needle, and I have a dish here I'll show you. But the way that I do it, the way I magnetize my needles, is I get to a piece of 14 gauge wire. This is just typical Romex that you buy at any of your box stores, Home Depot or Lowe's or wherever you buy your building supply materials at. Take the Romex, strip it out, get you about a 3 foot section, and then you want to create these little curly cues. And the way you do that is you just put the needle in that little area right there and you continue to wrap it around it. But the first thing you want to do is you want to put a piece of red tape, because that's going to represent the positive side of what we're going to do to magnetize this needle. And the way that you remember how you want to magnetize the needle is that the tip of the needle needs to be facing the red tape. So you're going to put this needle in these little curly cues, like so, and this needle has not been magnetized yet. So notice I have the tip of the needle, okay, facing the red section of my lead. I've got a 12 volt battery under my desk here, so I'm going to go and just put this on the positive and the negative side. You got to be careful because it will spark. Just do it for a second. You don't have to leave it on there. Just do it for a second. Now, I don't recommend doing this with the battery connected in your car, because you may short something out or blow a fuse or something, but do it on a regular battery. You can do it on a 6 volt battery if you want to run them in parallel or series rather, or a 12 volt battery works. So I like to use just a regular 12 volt battery. So let me go magnetize this, I'll be right back. Okay, so I didn't get shocked, but there were some sparks. Now my needle has been magnetized, and you might want to check it and make sure it's not hot. Now the wire shouldn't heat up the needle, because this is insulated. Don't do it with a completely stripped wire, or you're going to shock yourself. So when you do this, make sure you're using an insulated piece of wire. Okay, so now your needle has been magnetized, meaning that if you put it in water, it should point to the magnetic north, right? So I have a compass, a little trusty Suunto here. So now we're going to test and see if this is true. Okay, so you can see on my compass, I've got red in the shed, and my compass is going to show me where north is. All right. So now you got a leaf. And we're going to drop the needle. Remember, I magnetized the point So now we're going to drop the needle, and it should be facing this way. So we're just going to turn it around the opposite way and see if it spins. You want to try to get this away. You need still water. You don't want to do this in moving water. A little mud puddle or something. So we'll drop that right there. And give it a second. Now, if your leaf does not start turning like that, then you've not properly magnetized your needle. Okay? And it should turn immediately. There you go. Okay, so let's suppose for a moment that you haven't taken this precaution and you haven't magnetized your needle and you don't have your wallet. Now what do? You don't have a compass, you don't have your needle. Is there other ways that you can help find north without anything? And the answer to that question is yes. Now I'm going to give you best guesses, because if I'm trying to determine a direction in the woods, there's a lot of factors that go into this. So I'm not going to use just one of these principles. I'm going to go through all of these steps, which is going to give me my best guess. So if I'm going to make an educated guess as to where north is, then I'm going to factor in all of these considerations and not just one. So let's talk about the wind for a second. All right. In the northern hemisphere, remember, in the northern hemisphere, the wind blows clockwise around a high pressure system and counterclockwise around a low pressure area, meaning that the winds on the earth travel in many directions and are dependent on proximity to the equator, like the jet stream, and of course the spin of the earth, known as the Coriolis effect or the Coriolis force. So if you're in the United States, and you're probably going to encounter an east wind on very rare occasions, unless you live out in the Outer Banks of North Carolina somewhere, you might get an offshore wind. But for most of the time, the winds are going to rotate, or the winds are going to come from the east and move to the, the winds are going to come from the west and move to the east, because of the jet stream and the spin of the earth, known as the Coriolis effect. So those are going to be westerly winds, the prevailing winds, most of the time, okay? So if you live in the latitude of 30 and 60 degrees on the equator, there's a good chance that the wind is blowing, it's coming from the west, all right? Now, keep in mind, there's an exception to everything. So that's why I said you've got to take all of these things and put them all into an equation to help give you an assessment as to what direction you're going in. But just, if you're out in the middle of nowhere and you don't have a needle or a compass, figure out which way the wind's blowing, all right? Now, the second thing that you can do is you can look at water, all right? And there's an old wives' tale that says that all rivers move from north to south. And while that may be a smart observation, okay, it's not necessarily true. In the United States, pretty much most of the rivers, the major rivers in the United States, they do flow north to south. But the Ohio River and the Columbia River do not. They flow west. Mostly. I mean, they make some changes, but everybody's always said, find a river and look at which direction it's going in, because it's going to run north to south. That is not true. The direction of most rivers are going to follow not a direction or a point on a compass, but they're going to follow what's called gravity, because they're flowing from a high point to a low point. So a lot of times, if you're trying to get to the lowest point of a terrain or the topography, then yeah, that makes sense. Follow the direction of a river. But don't discount that and don't rule that out if you're looking at the wind and you see a river and you see that the wind is blowing from east to west, and you see, draw that line on the ground. Okay, my wind's blowing this way, and then look at a river, and you say, okay, the river is moving that way. That's something to look at. The third thing that you can look at is moss. Now, I did some hiking in the Cascades one winter, and I realized that this wasn't true, because the moss in the Cascades pretty much grows all the way around the tree, because moss doesn't necessarily grow on the north side of the tree, but moss will always have a tendency to grow on the shady side of a tree, because moss doesn't have a vascular system. That plant doesn't have tap roots, so it depends on water to keep it alive. And so it's going to grow, particularly in the forest, it's going to grow wherever that sun's not shining. And most of the time, that is on the north side of the tree. Okay, so keep that in mind. So, but you've got to remember that there's three kinds of norths. There's a magnetic north, there's a true north, and then there's what's called a grid north. And just a real quick overview of those three differences. True north, of course, is a line from any point on the Earth's globe or the Earth's surface that runs straight to the North Pole. That's called true north. Magnetic north is the direction of the magnetic pole that the needle and compass will find, or your magnetic needle will find, or your Sunto compass will find. It's always going to find the magnetic north pole. There is a angle of variance between true north and magnetic north, and that's called declination. And declination is simply the variance, depending upon where you're at on the planet, between true north and magnetic north. And there's a lot of websites online that can tell you what your declination point variance is. There are a lot of calculators online that you can look up and just put in your GPS location, and it'll tell you what that degree of variance is. So for me in North Carolina, my declination, my variance between magnetic north and true north is six degrees. Okay, a lot of your maps talking about grid north, most of the time you're a good map will give you what that declination is. But on a map, grid north is obviously the lines that are on the map, and you have to obviously orientate that map based upon true north, or magnetic north rather. So I hope the purpose of this lesson or this video will help you if you ever get lost in the woods. And there's a couple other tricks we can talk about for another video, using the moon and the orbit of the moon, or the rising and setting of the moon. And I've used this before, and once again, if I'm looking at all four of these measurements, if I'm making these observations, then that's going to help me. So if I'm really, really confused, then I might wait till night, and then I might observe the moon. We all know the moon rises and sets the same way the sun does. So the moon rises in the east and it sets in the west. But if you look at the moon most of the time in the middle of the night, it's pretty much going to hang out in the southern sky. So at dawn and dusk is when you're going to see the moon moving, predominantly moving. But in the middle of the night, the moon's going to be pretty much hanging out in the southerly sky. And there's also a trick that you can use with an analog watch. And I don't really like that method, because a lot of people don't use analog watches anymore, you know, not a digital watch. But if you want to look that up, there's another way you can find north as well, with using an analog watch. And we all know about how to create a sundial too. You can put some sticks in the ground, and you can also do that with the moon. So there's many different ways you can find true north in magnetic north, but probably the simplest way is to take the time and to take that preventive measure and go ahead and magnetize you a Sailmakers needle and keep it in your wallet, and you'll never ever be lost. So until next time, I want to encourage you to be safe.